afternoon, everyone. I'd like to welcome you all to the first in our Rotman lecture series today. Henrik Lagerlund, the chair of the Department of Philosophy, will introduce our speaker in just a moment. But I want to say a few words first to welcome you all, and also the people who might be joining us via video stream, and to mention the upcoming events that the Rotman Institute is hosting. 2 weeks from now, there will be a talk by George Reich entitled The Paranoid Style of American History of Science. And the following week, there will be a workshop that's co-hosted by the Rotman Institute and the Center for Philosophy of Science on the language of nature. And the local member of the organizing committee for that is Ben Hill. So please keep those in mind, and I hope you, in addition to enjoying today's talk, consider coming to future talks. So without further ado, I'll turn matters over to Henrik Lagerlund to introduce today's.
That was surprising. So, thank you all for coming, everybody that's here and everybody that's watching online. It's my great pleasure to introduce Professor Stephen Gaukroger. He is a PhD out of Cambridge and Cambridge University and in England, right? And now he is professor of history of philosophy and history of science at the University of Sydney. He told me he has just left Aberdeen, where he had a joint appointment for a while. Now Stephen is very well known. He's one of the world-leading scholars on early modern philosophy, and certainly one of the foremost historians of science in the world. I think the first time I ran into something that he had written was one of his first books on Cartesian logic, which I read in grad school. It was very important to me. I followed his work throughout my career, I should say. I enjoyed his books on Descartes, his biography of Descartes, the intellectual biography, which is very important. He just published a book in the very short introductory series that Oxford has on objectivity, which I haven't had the pleasure to read yet. I have been following, though, his latest and major project, which I think today's lecture is part of, that big project. It's a four-volume project on which the subtitle of it is Science and the Shaping of Modernity. And so far, he's published two books on Oxford. The first one, The Emergence of a Scientific Culture. The second one, The Collapse of Mechanism and the Rise of Sensibility. And the third one is In the Making. The title is The Naturalization of the Human and the Humanization of Nature. And there will be a fourth volume which carries this project all the way up to contemporary science. So, further ado, it's my great pleasure to introduce Stephen Gaukroger as the first speaker in the Rotman speaker series. The title of his talk today is Metaphysics and Sensibility, Diderot, Hume, Baumgarten, and Gaukroger. Please welcome Stephen Gaukroger.
For the very kind introduction, and of course thank you also to the Rotman Institute for the invitation to speak in this very prestigious series. I'm very flattered. Now I imagine no one here is thinking, oh no, not another lecture on Baumgarten. But just in case you kind of be wondering why I want to talk about this, my main concern today is really with the naturalization of reason, which are one of the projects for the naturalization of reason, one of the non-reductionist projects for the naturalization of reason in the 18th century. So I think the topic may speak to broader interests. Okay, well, one of the most urgent philosophical concerns of the second half of the 18th century was that of reconciling or choosing between the competing demands of reason and sensibility. And in looking at this question today, I want to begin by looking briefly at two developments which, when combined, prepare the ground for the general thesis that I want to defend. The first of these developments is the generalization of what in Locke is a distinction between reason and sensation into a distinction between reason and sensibility. And this effectively begins with French Lockeans, such as Condillac. It's continued in Buffon and in Diderot, and I'm going to focus on Diderot. What looks at first like something narrowly epistemological turns out to have a central moral and social dimension. The move from sensation to sensibility, that's what this move brings with it. A move from epistemology to very general questions, not just about cognition, but about moral and social issues as well. The second development is the radicalization of this dichotomy between reason and sensation, reason and sensibility, in Hume. Hume, as I'm sure you all know, stresses the inadequacy of reason. But also, unlike Rousseau, for example, he stresses its necessity. This generates a dilemma. And combined with the first development, which highlights just how important it is to get the relation between reason and sensibility right, the Humean dilemma takes on a wholly new significance. And this really provides my launch into the more general theme that I'm going to be concerned with. I've got to look at two opposed solutions to this dilemma on how the standing of reason might be saved. The first is that of Baumgarten, who tries to rationalize sensibility by showing how it can be subordinated to reason. And the second is that of Herder, who takes an already naturalized sensibility and makes reason commensurate with it through a process of further naturalization. So the end point of the talk really is Herder, and what Herder thinks he's doing in his attempt to naturalize reason. And more interestingly, how he tries to do this. Okay, let me start with Diderot. Questions of the connection between sensibility and sensation were introduced into French thought in the 1740s, particularly in the work of Condillac and Buffon. Both independently used the image of a human stature, which is progressively given sensory faculties. They did this in order to explore just what's needed to produce a conscious, self-aware human being, starting from just a piece of matter. What do you have to add to get the kind of thing that we know human beings are? We're invited to imagine a human statue which we bring alive by attributing one by one various sensory faculties to it, asking what its experience of the world would be like at each stage. Imagine we give the statue the power to smell and place a rose in front of its nose so that the statue experiences the odor of the rose. There's nothing in this that would lead the statue to imagine that the experience had an external source. So the olfactory sensation is not experienced as being that of an external object, but simply as a state that the perceiver is in. Similarly, so the argument goes, for the power to hear, see, and taste. Even the statue is playing with all five of the senses, which was able to compare, reflect, remember, and accomplish the other intellectual operations, would not be led, on these grounds alone, to imagine that its states were anything but internal and self-contained. Despite having a grasp of the spatial relations, for example, the statue would be solipsistic. Its sensory experiences would not project it into or connect it with the world. On the contrary, it would remain isolated and self-contained. The question now is how it's possible for us to develop a conception of the world as independent of us. Buffon's view was that only touch can provide a sense of an external world, and with this sense effectively comes a precondition for morality, in that with it comes a recognition of the existence of others, and a love for them replaces the earlier narcissism, the narcissism of the solipsist. Cognac's answer to the question is that a sense of reflection emerges from the sensations, allowing us to distinguish our own body from the sensations themselves. By combining the sensations and making something new out of them, in which the various objects of sensation can be compared under different descriptions. The crucial point, though, is that for both Buffon and Cognac, sensibility and a recognition of an external world come together and simultaneously. Recognition of an external world requires sensibility. An intellect, reason, could not do this by itself. For those thinkers in the French Lockean tradition, it's axiomatic to the sensationalist project that one begins life with a tabula rasa. And the question is how one develops a cognitive, affective, and moral life on this basis. Diderot develops this line of thought most fully, explicitly linking sensation with moral and aesthetic sensibility. And he does this through an exploration of the mentality of someone who's deprived of sensory capacities in some way. In his account of blindness, for example, he compares the blind with the sighted in order to explore what this tells us about sensibility in general. A deficient sensibility, for Diderot, is primarily a question of an emotional, aesthetic, and moral challenge. And because of their impoverished sensibilities, the blind turn their minds inwards and are drawn to thinking in terms of abstractions. The blind offer a crucial case study for Diderot because he believes that their abstract manner of experiencing pain in others weakens their sense of sympathy for the sufferings of others. His target is not confined to the blind, however. The blind just manifests in a particularly concrete way a general insensibility to the world on the part of those who think and experience it in terms of abstractions. And he's particularly concerned with Cartesians in the French context. But the German metaphysical tradition, as represented, for example, by Wolf, would also be a prime contender for this status. So really, he's targeting philosophers. They think of the world in abstract intellectual terms. This reduces their sensibility. It reduces their moral, their moral, aesthetic, and sensory standing. For Diderot, our relation to the world depends very much upon how we arrive at that relation. And one assimilates cognitive information in the course of growing up, the course of one's education, in a process which is always and necessarily social, cultural, and has moral implications. These are all tied together. So that what is shaped is not merely a cognitive sensibility, but a sensibility in which cognitive, affective, and moral questions are inextricably tied together. What's ultimately at stake is the sensory basis of civic life, where the contrast is between sensibility on the one hand and a solipsistic rationalism on the other. The general question underlying this is that of where the ideas that regulate our lives, our moral, emotional, social, political, intellectual lives, where these ideas come from. The approach of those metaphysicians and others who conceive of the world in abstract terms, and as a consequence examine our relation to it in these same terms, now becomes not merely misguided, but socially and morally irresponsible. Hume. By the middle of the 18th century, the question of the relation between reason and sensibility had started to become a pressing problem. And it was Hume's formulation, more than any other, that was to challenge philosophers, particularly in Germany, from the 1760s onwards. Hume raised a dilemma with respect to the nature of understanding. Simplifying somewhat, he came to the view that the most developed form of systematic general understanding, metaphysics, led to paradoxical conclusions, which were so contrary to the common life, as he put it, that we could not accept them as true. Yet to the extent to which we desire to develop a critical understanding of the world and our moral and other practices, we can't renounce such forms of philosophical inquiry. We're faced with a mode of life and thought that leads to dangerous and ridiculous fantasies, but which is part of the thoughtful existence distinctive of civilization, by contrast with an unreflective mode which he associates with barbarism. We can think of Hume as generalizing from an account of natural philosophy developed by Locke. For Locke, there's a shifting balance between the demands of systematic explanation and those of experimental natural philosophy. Hume, in effect, transfers this view to knowledge in general. He doesn't deny that the understanding can take a systematic form, only that the kind of understanding that can take a systematic form, and he's really concerned with metaphysics in this context, cannot be constitutive of our understanding of the world. There is systematic understanding, there's no problem with systematic understanding, so long as it doesn't purport to be comprehensive. So long as it doesn't purport to be the only ultimate form of understanding, which of course it does. It can be part of our understanding of the world, and indeed he believes, by contrast with later common sense school critics such as Reid, it must be part of it, but not all of it. Hume offers an account of human understanding whereby it's a judicious balancing of propositional and non-propositional considerations, of considerations of reason and sensibility. Hume's use of skeptical arguments to undermine the claims of systematic metaphysics came in time to be immensely influential. But equally important was his own practice as an essayist and historian, which had a more immediate impact. It was in this latter capacity that his life and work manifested the other side of the balance between systematic and non-systematic inquiry. The essays in particular balanced the skeptically driven metaphysical writings, and the two represented two different personae, as it were, both equally necessary. Here we have what's most distinctive about Hume's position, I think, namely his refusal to choose between systematic and non-systematic considerations. His combination of a commitment to a skeptically driven form of inquiry as absolutely central to our critical engagement with the world in which we live, on the one hand, and his demonstration of the absurdities to which this necessarily leads, on the other, leads Hume to a distinctive view of the role and nature of judgment. His view is that understanding consists in the exercise of judgment between considerations that are not exclusively propositions. What's distinctive about his judgment is that it is not a philosophical judgment as such. That's to say, it's not a judgment that the philosopher, qua philosopher, is best qualified to make. If one wants to judge the good life, this is not something that any particular group, theologians or metaphysicians, have any real claim on. But of course, as traditionally conceived, for example, if one thinks of the philosophical tradition from Plato and Aristotle, an answer to the question how to live is precisely the ultimate goal of philosophy. And it's a goal that establishes the autonomy of philosophy with regard to theology, for example. Even worse, metaphysics and other disciplines are compared in terms of what Hume calls natural history, something deriving from the experimental philosophy tradition and its empiricist successor. and which he uses to naturalize inquiry on the one hand, while denying any systematicity or even a unified program to natural philosophy on the other. Now, Hume's attack on metaphysics put its aspirations in question. But the ground had been softened by a number of other thinkers. Systematic metaphysics did not fare at all well in the early to mid-18th century, and was regaled across the spectrum from radical Parisian philosophes to conservative Jesuits. The only metaphysical program of any significance was that of Wolff, for whom it was part of the reform of the German university system. Distinguishing between what he calls historical knowledge, which concerns itself with empirical and causal matters, and philosophical knowledge, which works from basic principles, Wolff rejected the traditional ascendancy of theology, jurisprudence, and medicine in the universities, arguing that they were merely historical forms of inquiry. Whereas philosophy could raise knowledge to the level of what the scholastics had termed scientia, comprehensive understanding based on first principles. The recent sensibility distinction gets translated here into a specific metaphysics versus empirical history contrast in the German context. What Wolff offered was a basically scholastic metaphysics reformulated along Leibnizian lines. He began by rewriting logic in Leibnizian terms, conceiving the aim to be the provision of a means whereby confused concepts were analysed and made clear and distinct. That's what logic was. That was the function of logic. The procedure was then applied to the whole of philosophy, conceived as a discipline that investigated why things are as they are. The model was explicitly that of mathematics, where necessary truths were revealed by establishing the systematic connections that propositions have with one another. The systematic metaphysics that results on this conception has no place for sensation, which it construes simply as a form of cognition, namely sensory perception, which produces only obscure ideas. But by mid-century, such a dismissive view of sensibility is simply no longer viable. And the central problem for those pursuing philosophy via metaphysics was what account to give of sensibility. Wolff had made it clear that every area of inquiry should be pursued with scientific rigour, but he'd done little to further the study of arts and humanities on this basis. The one significant development of the Wolffian programme in Baumgarten's Aesthetica of 1750 was on this question. And he proposed, or what he would propose, was a science of what he called the lower faculties, lower reason. He'd already noted in his earlier Meditationes that in promising to improve our knowledge, logic actually promises more than it can deliver. Because logic deals with intellectual cognition, whereas human cognition generally also involves sensory cognition. So if we rely on logic alone, will leave a whole realm in its original unanalyzed state. In particular, if we allow the intellect to rule the lower cognitive faculties, this will have detrimental consequences for art, producing something frigid and scholastic. Because we find a richness and vividness in sensory perception that's lacking in purely intellectual cognition. Baumgarten terms the study of sense perception aesthetics, and he argues that it is, quote, the younger sister of logic. Whereas logic deals with intellectual cognition, aesthetics deals with the lower cognitive powers, namely sensory cognition. Indeed, logic is clearly the model. The role of logic on this conception is to make confused concepts distinct through analysis. And Baumgarten's aim is to perfect our powers of perception. As a means to understanding what this would consist in, he sets out to establish that perfected perception is equivalent to beauty, so that his science of sensory cognition now becomes a critique of taste. That's to say, he makes a direct link between sense perception and aesthetic sensibility. Moreover, there's a set of rules by which the perfectibility of the two can be achieved. One important difference between intellect and sensory faculties is that whereas the intellect operates by means of demonstrative inference, the confused elements of sensory faculties are related through association. And Baumgarten identifies what he calls the law of the imagination, namely, that the partial perception of an idea conjures up the whole idea, and he associates this with the law of association of ideas. Just as there's a natural logic, that's to say, a grasp of inferential relations prior to any education in logic, so too there's a natural aesthetic, which children exercise in their sensory exploration of the world, above all in playing games. And just as natural logic can be perfected through training in rules developed through an analysis of inference, so too can natural aesthetics be improved in an analogous way. The model for analysing the sensory realm is drawn here exclusively from that devised for analysing the intellectual realm. And aesthetics falls under a general comprehensive metaphysics for Baumgarten. The fact that it works via association of ideas rather than deductive inference between ideas does not mean that aesthetics, qua study of sensation, is a genuinely autonomous discipline, because it's not. Quite the contrary, it remains resolutely subservient to reason for Baumgarten. But here, we have a model of how we might take sensibility seriously, in a way that Wolf hadn't, a model for how we might take sensibility seriously, yet subsume it under reason. But this was not the model that was taken up in the middle decades of the 18th century. In France and Germany, the question of the relation between sensibility and reason had become highly polemicized in the 1750s and 1760s through the influence of Rousseau. In Britain, Rousseau's influence was significantly weaker. But what Rousseau represented for many philosophers, an essayist of wit and urbanity, whose philosophical interests went well beyond those subjects that fell under traditional metaphysics, and someone who represented a philosophical persona quite different from that of the metaphysician, what Rousseau represented was something that could also be found in Hume, the essayist and historian. Moreover, both dealt with moral, political, education, and pedagogic questions, those questions that would fall under the moral sciences. And they dealt with them in terms of anthropology, in the original sense, rather than in terms of metaphysics, or Christian teaching, or civic humanism was traditionally conceived. Although Rousseau and Hume drew different conclusions on many of the questions they explored, what was crucial was their way of pursuing the subject, and their questioning of the power of reason to regulate a range of issues from morality and aesthetics to epistemology and religious belief. The two tended to be drawn together in Germany, where we find the influence of Rousseau balanced to some extent by Hume, especially in as much as Hume is associated with the project of the natural life psychology. In mid-century, British and French ideas were introduced into Berlin in particular, in the context of a growing hostility to Wolffian Schule philosophy, or scholastic philosophy, and a revival of what was seen as Tomasius's eclecticism. Above all, the material from France and Britain was disseminated through journals announcing their subject matter as Schönen Kunst und Wissenschaft. Beautiful science, or beautiful arts, correspond to the French term belles lettres, humane learning by contrast with logic, metaphysics, and theology. What's happening in this literature is that there's a shift of learning generally, including the sciences, from an academic culture into an essay culture, one whose audience is the Republic of Letters. Although the shift might be viewed as bringing Germany into alignment with Britain and France, the relative suddenness and abruptness of the transition, together with the fact that the leading figures were incorporating this shift into an explicit program of political and cultural reform, meant that the rejection of metaphysics as a vehicle of thought about an engagement with fundamental issues about the nature of the world and our place in it, a rejection of metaphysics as something that can legitimately play this role, raised the whole question of the value of particular modes of inquiry, and in particular, whether any overarching form of understanding was possible. Now, Hume had rejected the idea that there's some meta-discipline, traditionally identified with metaphysics, that can stand over all other disciplines and critically evaluate them, while at the same time being itself exempt from any such evaluation. But he did employ an overarching form of inquiry himself, which he refers to as natural history. Somehow, natural history plays this role without being immune to criticism itself, and without being uniquely empowered to offer criticism of other disciplines. So what exactly is this natural history? Natural history, in the literal sense, is a classificatory discipline, traditionally associated with mineralogy, botany, zoology, and so on. But it acquires more complex senses in Bacon at the beginning of the 17th century, and then in Boyle and the defense of experimental natural philosophy in the second half of the 17th century. The central contrast in the experimental natural philosophy tradition is between, on the one hand, an experimental form of natural philosophy, which identifies and accounts for problematic phenomena at a purely phenomenal level, without recourse to any idea of any underlying cause in them. And on the other hand, systematic natural philosophy refers explanations to an underlying microscopic level, on the understanding that this is where the real action happens, the level of microforces. What's at issue is whether all explanations must take the form of deducing the macroscopic behavior of bodies from the behavior of their microscopic constituents. Advocates of experimental natural philosophy, beginning with Boyle, urged the legitimacy and fruitfulness of drawing connections between phenomena. If we take natural history in this sense, then we can perhaps see how we might conceive of a discipline that can in some ways help us to make sense of the relation between reason and sensibility, without having any pretensions to understanding these matters in terms of a system resting on a small number of basic truths, as metaphysics did, and without the aspiration to offer some absolute critical perspective which is itself immune to criticism, as metaphysics has done. Now, it is, I think, a natural assumption that what we need to work on if we're to achieve this goal is reason. Somehow, reason needs to be reformed if it's to abandon its aspiration to play the role of the ultimate critic, while itself remaining immune from any form of criticism. It is, of course, its relation with sensibility that presents the problems, so sensibility has to be understood properly. But this could presumably be achieved without reason shedding its autonomy. Another approach, a diametrically opposed one, is to examine how one accounts for sensibility, and then ask whether we might approach reason from the perspective of sensibility. And this is now the path that I want to go on. This is Hare's path. You start with sensibility, you look at how you analyze sensibility, and then you ask, can we apply the same resources and procedures to reason? Can we understand reason in the same way that we understand sensibility, rather than the other way around? The other way around is the approach of Baumgarten. Hare's approach is to start not from reason and see how that can be how that can act as a model of sensibility, but to start with sensibility and see how that can act as a model for reason. One apparent obstacle to this strategy is the sheer diversity of the phenomena that fall under the rubric of sensibility, especially when compared to reason, which gives every appearance of being intrinsically unified. Well, the diversity is not, in fact, as much of an impediment as it might first appear. We can distinguish four phenomena that fall under the term as used at the time. And I take these from the definition of sensibilité in the Encyclopédie. Aesthetic sensibility,
a kind of awareness or appreciation that accompanies perceptual cognition in varying degrees, moral sensibility, an ability to exercise untutored moral discrimination, sensation, something that figures in our cognitive relation to the world, and sensitivity, something that accompanies certain kinds of physiological activity, we would say maybe neurological activity. These are not unconnected phenomena. As Anvila's pointed out, sensibility was the essential link between the human body and the psychological, intellectual, and ethical faculties. It helped to unify the human faculties, as it was seen as the root of all human perceptions and reflections, as the innate and active principle of sociability that gave rise to human society, as a kind of sixth sense whose special effective energy was essential to both virtue and to art, and finally, as the paradigmatic vital force whose actions could be detected in every bodily function, be it healthy or morbid. Now, one crucial unifying feature of the diverse phenomena that came under the rubric of sensibility lay in how they were being accounted for. This is the crucial move as far as naturalization is concerned. One of the distinctive features of sensibility is the extent to which it was becoming naturalized by the middle of the 18th century. This took many forms, from the attempts of moral philosophers such as Hume and others to treat political, social, and economic questions in terms that went beyond both traditional Christian thinking and civic humanism, to the attempts of those working within the life sciences, most notably Buffon, to extend their account of zoology into the human and social realms. Its characteristic feature is the replacement of speculative by empirical forms of inquiry. This has consequences for what we consider the role of reason to be, and how we think of reason. The key question is that of how our beliefs and values are shaped. Whereas philosophers have traditionally assumed that reason and the passions play the crucial role here, typically, not universally, thinking of the passions as an obstacle to reason, we're led in a different direction if we approach reason from the consideration of sensibility. So finally, I come to Herder. This is the direction that Herder takes. Reason, in Herder, is not simply assimilated to sensibility. It becomes subjected, reason becomes subjected to an empirical, comparative form of treatment which actually emphasizes its distinctive characteristics. So it's not being reduced to anything. If anything, its autonomy is being enhanced. Wolf had distinguished rational from empirical psychology, and the latter, empirical psychology, plays a key role in Herder's strategy. It worked through an analysis of the behavior of others and an analysis of our own psychological states. And Wolf writes that it is, quote, really a history of the soul and can be known without any other discipline. Empirical psychology provided the raw materials for rational psychology, in that the task of rational psychology was to derive the results of empirical psychology from a priori first principles. So if you like, empirical psychology provided you with the empirical raw material, then you had to work on this through rational psychology, you had to organize them in terms of a priori principles, with a view to achieving clarity and distinctness. This kind of move from empirical to rational psychology was a form of subsumption of empirical under rational psychology. But at the same time, for Wolf and Baumgarten, there was a continuum between higher and lower faculties, between understanding and sensibility. This opens up the possibility of another form of inquiry, one in which the aim is to explore the relation between the faculties as placed along the continuum. This latter would be a form of history in Wolf's terms, natural history in Hume's terms. In itself, it wouldn't rule out the project of subsuming sensibility under reason. But if one had independent objections to such a project, objections that were plentiful from the 1750s, then it would provide a potentially promising alternative route. What in Wolffian terms were the lower faculties would now be reassessed, being called upon to provide the model for analysis of the higher ones. It was a matter of using the resources employed to explore sensibility, resources that were highly naturalized, to explore the understanding. The inquiry now becomes empirical, not speculative, quite different from the facultative logic that the Wolffian tradition takes over from Leibniz as a route to the clarification of ideas. I want to distinguish two sets of resources that help Herder to follow this empirical path. The first is something that he takes over from developments in the life sciences, and more broadly speaking, matter theory. It offers a picture of natural philosophy which makes possible an understanding of living things, which the earlier mechanist model had unsuccessfully tried to account for in reductive terms. A new theory of matter construes matter as active, not inert, and it introduces developmental considerations into natural history in a fundamental way. The second is an extension of naturalizing resources to include language, so that it's no longer merely a means of expression of thoughts, but something that goes to the heart of what it is to think. Analyzing thought through language offers a potential avenue for naturalization that wouldn't be available if language was simply a means of expression which had no content in its own right, or no substance in its own right. Let's consider the natural philosophical question first. Sensibility could hardly act as a model of naturalization if itself it couldn't be naturalized. If sensation and sensibility couldn't be accounted for in naturalistic terms, for example, then the project simply couldn't get off the ground. The mechanist model of natural philosophy, whose most successful version was that offered by Descartes, was premised on the notion of inert matter. The underlying idea was that the mechanically characterized behavior of inert microscopic corpuscles was constitutive of all physical events. On this conception, such phenomena as nervous sensibility were reduced to biomechanics, basically inert matter moving under pressure. By the early decades of the 18th century, the limits of this form of reductive explanation had become evident in chemistry, electricity, and physiology, as well as in the life sciences. In its place, they developed a notion of matter as inherently active. Electrical conductivity, chemical reactions, and muscular and nervous action as paradigmatic examples of this activity. The most striking example, however, came from the life sciences, notably from the discovery in 1740 of the reproductive behavior of the freshwater polyp, or hydra. The hydra regenerated by budding like a plant, even though in every other respect it is classified as an animal. But even more remarkably, when cut into multiple parts, each part would regenerate with all the features of the whole polyp. Mouth, arms, legs, stomach appearing, no matter from what segment of the original the cut part came. Matter, it seemed, contained vital powers. Matter as envisaged by mechanists, it was now argued, wasn't matter per se, as mechanists believed, but simply dead matter. That is, matter that had lost all its interesting active and vital powers and was reduced to a mere shell. Indeed, advocates of the new understanding of matter, such as Maupertuis, replaced the mechanist micro-macro distinction with an inner-outer one. It wasn't the smallest parts of matter that explained the behavior of the larger ones, but the inner properties of matter that explained the outer behavior. Size was replaced by depth. It wasn't just vital phenomena that fared better on this conception, but a whole range of things that were wholly inexplicable on the corpuscularian model. Why chemical substances reacted in constant proportions, and why no mechanical force could separate the original components once they'd been combined. There's no corpuscular explanation for that. Why in physiological processes such as reflex action, the response far exceeded the stimulus and force, in apparent contravention of the basic laws of mechanics, particularly Newton's third law, the equality of action and reaction, and so on. As well as a new understanding of matter as active, allowing the vital phenomena that made up sensibility to be incorporated into a general form of natural philosophy, there was a second element that had a more direct impact on Herder's project. Maupertuis, in studying heredity, had been led to an appreciation of developmental history. And Buffon had argued for the indispensability of a developmental perspective in understanding natural history. Indeed, Buffon took developmental questions as providing the explanatory core of natural history, engaging the methodological questions of truth and evidence that this raises, such as the question of how, using only what we can observe at present, we can reconstruct the past of the solar system and the Earth, for example. At the same time, in the extensive preliminary discourse of the Encyclopédie, D'Alembert and Diderot were accounting for the present state of knowledge in terms of the genealogy of reason, showing how religious and other obstacles to learning had not only hindered, but skewed scientific understanding. In the process, they thought they were identifying just what it was that had been necessary for the present state of scientific understanding to be reached. There are, then, two mid-century developments on which Herder can rely. The first was a confidence that with the rethinking of matter as something active, basic phenomena of sensibility can be dealt with at a reasonably fundamental level as part of a comprehensive natural philosophy. The second was the existence of models of explanation through developmental history. We can think of Herder's project in terms of a threefold naturalization. First, he approaches reason by understanding it in terms of thought. Very standard move at the time. You understand reason, you translate the discourse on reason into a discourse about thought. Second, he approaches thought via what the Wolffian tradition characterized as empirical psychology. And third, the tool that he uses in this empirical psychology is language, which he treats as an empirically analyzable manifestation. So reason is treated in terms of thought, thought is treated in terms of empirical psychology, and empirical psychology proceeds via language, which is an empirically analyzable manifestation of thought. Moreover, it's an empirically analyzable manifestation that has a historical dimension. The history of languages, history in the 18th century sense, something that has both a diachronic and a synchronic dimension. The history of languages is a history of thought, which in turn is now a history of reason, albeit one of a far more subtle form than the kind of triumph of the present type history we get in Diderot and D'Alembert. The move from reason to thought is a move from speculative metaphysics to empirical psychology. In itself, this was not especially contentious. And empirical psychology played a crucial role in the Wolffian tradition. But this role was above all a necessary preparatory one, organizing the raw materials upon which an a priori structure could then be imposed, and thereby yielding a degree of clarity and understanding which empirical psychology in its own right couldn't aspire to. The first stage was as far as the Wolffian program could get with sensibility, at least before its reform by Baumgarten. So that it was considered that the problem with sensibility was that it could never aspire to anything beyond the kind of limited and necessarily obscure comprehension offered by empirical psychology. But the project of providing metaphysical structure had now fallen into disrepute outside what was by this stage a very small Wolffian circle, not least because of Hume's onslaught on metaphysics. In its place, what was now effectively being proposed was that the kind of understanding offered by empirical psychology was really all we had, as far as understanding was concerned. And that with an expansion of its resources, it was actually a much more powerful explanatory tool than its treatment in the hands of metaphysicians would suggest. If empirical psychology was to go beyond the role that it played in the metaphysical project, if it was to offer an analysis of thought that had genuine aspirations to clarity and understanding, thought, in all its distinctiveness, had somehow to be captured. Reason could not simply be rejected in favor of sensibility along Rousseauian lines. Nor could thought simply be reduced to a form of physiological activity along the lines that Lemaitre was proposing. If the project was to have any plausibility, thought had to retain some autonomy. There had to remain something distinguishing about it which successful explanation was able to capture. Language and thought had been associated from antiquity, and the close relation between the two was a given of 17th and 18th century culture. But Herder wants and needs something stronger than this. He wants analysis of language to be an analysis of thought. In his fragments on recent German literature from 1767 to 8, he writes that language, quote, is a form of cognition, not merely in which, but also in accordance with which, thoughts take shape. Where in all parts of literature, thought adheres to expression and forms itself in accordance with it. Such linguistic naturalism has an immediate advantage over materialist forms of reductionism, for these latter were widely deemed to commit one to determinism, whereas the linguistic naturalism that Herder is offering clearly has no such consequences. It just doesn't have any bearing on the question of determinism. Linguistic naturalism also has a positive advantage in that it allows a comparative form of study. By comparing earlier languages with present ones, by comparing contemporary languages with one another, one is comparing forms of thought. Herder set out a comprehensive account of language in his prize-winning essay on the origins of language, 1769. Responses were invited to a question by the Akademie der Wissenschaften in Berlin. Responses were invited to the question, if human beings had only their natural faculties, would they be able to invent language? And by what means could they invent it? In rejecting the view that language has been given to us by God, Herder does not assume that naturalist alternatives are necessarily on the right track. He's quick to criticize those theories of language that find the origins of language in animal cries, for example. I cannot conceal my astonishment, he writes, that philosophers, that is people who seek distinct concepts, were ever able to arrive at the idea of explaining the origin of human language from this cry of sensations. For isn't it obvious that human language is something completely different? All animals, down as far as the dumb fish, sound forth their sensation. But it's still not the case that just because of that, any animals, even the most perfect, make the slightest real beginning towards a human language. Herder identifies Condillac and Rousseau as the prime culprits here. In both cases, the cognitive content of language is ignored. Yet, for Herder, this is precisely what we should be attempting to capture in a theory of the natural origins of language. How then does Herder propose that language originates? Well, he begins with the crucial contrast between animals and human beings. Animals work within a very confined range of activities and are well served by instinct for this. The human being, by contrast, quote, has no such uniform and narrow sphere where only a single sort of work awaits him. The world of occupations and destinies surrounds him. His senses and organization are not sharpened for a single thing. He has senses for everything, and hence naturally for each particular thing the weaker and duller senses. What he needs in these circumstances is not particulars, but general facts. Needs is the key word here, because Herder argues that human beings need language if they're to survive, by contrast with animals, who have no use for it. Language provides a means of organizing our mental life. It orders and clarifies our experience by individuating things in such a way as to re-identify them, by providing a means of storing and conveying general facts. Without this, our distinctively human form of life would not be possible. The transformation of the study of reason into an empirical discipline inaugurates a form of anthropology which was in direct competition not just with metaphysics, but also with Christian theology and traditional humanist thought. Although it's been overshadowed by the Kantian division of pre-critical philosophy into rationalism and empiricism, the divide between anthropological and speculative inquiry is indeed a fundamental division, and one I think that might provide a more useful category than rationalism and empiricism, not just for historians of philosophy, but for philosophers more generally. Thank you.
No, there's a button on the bottom. That one. Hold the other. Hold the button until the light turns green. No. That one might be dead. Oh no! There it goes.
So I have what may be a larger, more serious question about Hume, but I want to make sure first if I understood what you're saying about Hume, and I also have a smaller, less serious question about Diderot. So first of all, when you were characterizing Hume's method, and you seem to be relating it to a kind of a Boyle-like project of relating phenomena to phenomena, were you talking just about his essays and his history, or were you also talking about, for instance, the project of the treatise and inquiries? I think I've heard on that before.
I'm talking about I'm including the latter as well.
Okay, so then I do have a question for you about that. Because, at the beginning of the treatise, Hume says, I am embarking on a Newtonian, Newtonian project of the mind, it seems to me that it's too much of a simplification to say that he just considers phenomena throughout the treatise, because he actually develops quite sophisticated theoretical framework of things that cannot be, I think, easily or thought of as direct phenomena that we have access to. His entire theory of the impressions is really quite theoretically rich. This idea of vivacity, that he bases his whole analysis on. And even in later chapters where he gives these quite bizarre thought experiments about in his analysis of envy and jealousy, talks about bringing the object closer to the person and taking it away, and the vivacity increases and decreases. One may type that as something like a Boyle-like purely phenomenal, albeit purely theoretical project. But I like to try and take him seriously. That he really is engaged actually in a much more theoretically grounded Newtonian-like project, and that in fact this theoretical ideas like vivacity are crucial and cannot be gained in a merely phenomenal way.
I think that in a sense the disagreement is what the Newtonian project is. The Newtonian project is not that of the Principia, it's more that of the optics, which of course Hume knew he didn't know the Principia at all. And that, think of Newton's first account of his experiment with colours. He's not interested in what corpuscular motions give rise to different colours. He's just interested in the phenomena. And because he's interested in the phenomena, he's interested in something that everyone else just overlooks, namely where the light comes through the prisms, it forms the spectrum, and the spectrum is lozenge-shaped instead of circular, which on all theories at the time should be circular, it's stretched, lozenge-shaped. This is what Newton finds interesting, and it's this that leads him to the account of the heterogeneity of white light. His critics, like Huygens and actually Spinoza, say, this is okay, but this is not natural philosophy. This is not telling us anything about the nature of light. That's what you should be doing. You ignored these basic questions of the nature of light. I see what Hume's doing, and obviously I would have to tinker and find this a bit, but broadly speaking, I see what Hume's doing as something like that. He's saying that he's denying that there's some single underlying system in terms of which we need to explain all these features of human behavior. There are theories with different depths, But there's no kind of overarching thing that we have to reconcile our observations with. In that sense, he's doing what he calls natural history.
So I'm a little puzzled by a characterization of Newton's first optical investigations, because in fact Newton does develop a very rich theoretical structure. In the very first paper from the 1660s, he actually develops a very rich theoretical vocabulary of simple homogeneal rays, complex heterogeneal mixtures of rays. He's already figured out that there that refrangibility is different measures of refrangibility are directly correlated with different color densities. It's actually extraordinarily rich set of conclusions.
I completely agree, and I also think that he could only do that proceeding the way he does. He could only quantify it by ignoring this idea that you must explain the corpuscular level what the nature of color is. So quantification and what I think of as a phenomenal Kantia go together. That's crucial. So it's theoretically rich, but it's not reductive. It's not microcorpuscularian. There's no single underlying structure of nature, which it's only when you explain things in those terms that you have the real explanation.
May I ask a small question about Diderot? I'm just curious. If I understood what you said about Diderot correctly, that certainly is Rameau's nephew as a buffoon. And
right. Yeah.
And I was kind of had sympathy with him. I thought Diderot himself did, but when he says happiness is to evacuate one's bowels once in the evening naturally, copiously, and quickly. I kind of get the feeling that Diderot actually had some sympathy for that position. It seems like you're just leaving.
Sorry, which position does do you have sympathy for?
That the statement that happiness is to evacuate one's bowels once in the evening naturally.
Okay. What did I say that seemed to go against that? Sorry.
No, I'm saying that quite generally, your picture of Diderot seemed to be of someone who, although didn't want to rely only on abstractions, still felt a need for some abstraction in human thought. And it struck me that on that picture, Rameau's nephew is really just love to be.
I haven't meant to give that impression, actually.
Okay.
I think Diderot is a very committed sensibilist.
Okay.
Yeah, and it is all sensibility. Not quite to the extent of Rousseau, but it is his central sensibility. Okay. So you're quite right, he does have some
Grandma's
behavior that you
have
mentioned.
Again!
It's such a great line.
Are there further questions?
Gerder and Buffon are this student. I was just wondering if you could tell us a little bit about the next chapter. Do we see with Gerder and Buffon a kind of culmination of a development that then gets eclipsed by a Kantian approach? Or is Kant drawing something from this, despite all appearances to the contrary? Just curious.
He does get eclipsed by, well, he gets eclipsed by German idealism, of course, which goes up in a completely different trajectory. He gets eclipsed by Kantianism, but rather than Kant. The anthropological tradition, as I understand it, kind of disappears with Herder, only to be revived later in the 19th century. A different form in modern thinking about, some forms of modern thinking about the mind, maybe. By the mid to late 19th century, you get this rationalism and empiricism thing reinstalled as the authorized historiography of philosophy. And of course, for those of us who work in early modern philosophy, know it's in many respects this is a disastrous distinction. It completely obscures the real interesting substantive issues and leads you off into
dead ends and blind alleys, if they're not the same thing. So this, what I'm critical of here is partly the historiography that comes with Kantianism, but the movement, this idea that there are ways of understanding the human condition other than in terms of metaphysics. Christian theology is not such an issue. And civic humanism is not such an issue. There are ways of understanding, there are ways of posing the big questions that are perhaps one might say, not philosophical. There are ways of posing big questions outside philosophy, and where philosophy isn't actually doing very well. Now that, I see, is the Hume anthropological strain. And that's the big question. And I think philosophers have got to take that seriously. And just naturalizing philosophical theories piecemeal might not be the answer. Maybe we want to understand, let me put it this way better. We want to understand certain questions that traditionally philosophers have directed themselves towards. Maybe we need to abandon traditional philosophical methods and treat them differently. And I think Hume's the first person to raise that possibility. To say, look, metaphysics, or philosophy, if you want to call it philosophy, is a very limited kind of enterprise. You can't push it beyond a certain stage. It's great up to a certain stage, but the trouble is, once you're into it, it's like drugs, you don't know when to stop. You go the further mile, and then you're led to absurdities. So it's a really dangerous discipline, but we can't do without it. But there are other ways of understanding the world. We include this, but there's other ingredients in our understanding of the world. I think that's the serious thing. That goes with Kant, because Kant says, Kant is the person who philosophizes, and Kant's answer to Hume is a philosophization of Hume. He sees this critique of metaphysics, and he gives a philosophical solution to the critique of metaphysics by rewriting what metaphysics is about at a fundamental level. So Kant, if you like, recoups all these questions that Hume had torn open back to philosophy. A new critique of pure reason type philosophy. It's quite different from anything earlier. So Kant brings the questions back into the philosophical world. The question is, was he right to do so? Mm. And the anthropological tradition, if you follow the head of trajectory, the suggestion is he wasn't right to do so. Can philosophy assimilate all the big questions to itself? And that Kantian tradition, which is still very much with us, says it can. That philosophy is a kind of master.
I'm tragic.
Yes.
I'm not a philosopher. I work with an ant.
With an
ant. I thought you said congratulations. But it's amazing listening to you speak because I really see connections between what you're saying and what she said. I mean, you use the human condition, the notion of stop and think, the notion that we need to perhaps philosophize our side of philosophy. And so I just want to...
That's very interesting. People always tell me I should read and write, and obviously I should.
So, given the revelations that you've unearthed for us in the modern period, could you speculate a little bit about how we, for instance, us here that are part of the Rotman Institute of Philosophy, how we could take those lessons about thinking outside of philosophy? How perhaps we can think about the future of philosophy in general as a discipline?
Well, I can tell you what my strategy is, you know. I'm not sure this is with your general recommendation, but with the kind of Quinean naturalization of philosophy, where it stops just being a question of conceptual analysis. I mean, there's still a core of conceptual analysis, but you draw on certain resources outside the discipline, empirical and other resources.
My own strategy is that, and this is why I say to people, I don't do history of philosophy, I do philosophy, but I do it through history of philosophy, history of science. My own thinking is to treat history of philosophy, history of science as a source, as a resource, as raising conceptual issues and looking at history of philosophy and history of science as a kind of resource of evidence. It's a kind of empirical resource. So it's not, I'm not going to the sciences, I'm going to the historical disciplines. And in that sense, I'm a Humean, and that's exactly what Hume did. It's the basic moral and political problems that he raises in the treatises. He follows through in detail in the history of England, for example, to some extent in the essays, but in the history of England, and he's looking at how the British Constitution emerges. He comes to a very detailed, he comes to a conclusion on the basis of a very detailed analysis that this is not people laying down basic principles like philosophers have done, but it's a long process of negotiation, compromise, mistakes, dead ends, and the rest of it. And conservative that he is, he thinks that's how these things work best in British culture. So he's using history as a kind of resource, as an arena of inquiry where you can find confirmation or disconfirmation, if you like, for your philosophical views. And I think you can use history, I think you can do the same with history of science and history of philosophy to some extent in that way. So I do think philosophy's got a conceptual core as an identity. That may just be a semantic point, but it's still pretty important for us in the discipline. But we need to think about what our sources of evidence and enlightenment are outside that sensory core. If we want to go beyond just conceptual analysis, what other resources are available to us? And I think it's ridiculous to think it's just the physical or the life sciences that provide empirical information. There are other things as well, and history of science is very, very rich in alerting us to basic misunderstandings, to contextualizing our own thought, to picking up on kind of dead ends that we might be going down, and you see analogous strategies of how they've led to dead ends previously. So I think that it adds what I'd call an empirical dimension, but it's a historical dimension, not a physics-based one.
Other questions?
Since nobody else is there, could I ask you to talk a little bit more about the idea of natural history? And is this sort of what you're getting at? That Hume's writing a history of England, which contains lots of remarks about warring religious factions, and is investigating how that conflict worked itself out in those specific circumstances. He's also writing Natural History of Religion, which we could look at as perhaps a generalization from what happened in England, what happened with the Henrys in France, church history, Roman history. Maybe a generalization from that to isolate certain principles that serve to explain events at the macro level without appeal to microphone. Is that sort of the idea?
It is, and you get a different kind of history. So, there's a thing in common to Bale, Hume, Gibbon, which is that in writing about religion and the history of religion, what's at issue is not whether it's true or false. That's not, the kind of analysis they carry out is without prejudice, so to speak, to whether it's true or false. So they look at the concrete development of religion at different stages, if they can identify them, how particular views are shaped within religion. But of course, what they're doing is naturalizing religion. I mean, this is much more dangerous for religion than the Parisian philosophes who say it's just a conspiracy of priests. You know, they do this, they say this, but they do that, and the rest of it. Much, much more dangerous is to say that religion can be treated in the same way as any other form of discourse. Politics, agriculture, any of those. There's a history that shows how its views develop. And that's a kind of desacralization. It's a naturalization of religion. Of course, that comes to a head in Strauss and then Feuerbach in the 19th century, where religion's completely humanized. It's just made another form of human activity. But in a sense, human is natural history of religion does that as well. This is just a form of human activity. So the kind of cutting edge of natural history is that you do end up with a different kind of analysis of religion, natural history of religion. You end up with a different kind of analysis of religion from that you normally get, which focuses on questions of truth and falsity. And that's the kind of metaphysical thing about religion. You know, what do you do in philosophy of religion? Well, are arguments for the existence of God valid or not? Well, you know, for these guys, that's just really a waste of time. That's not where the real issues are. I mean, it's not difficult to have sympathy with them. It's not about existence of God or not. It's about what kind of thing religion is. And the best way to study that is through natural history. And I think that the natural history of religion actually is a kind of prototype, a model for what Hume would have done had he completed a natural history of metaphysics. I think the model that it'd be, because he keeps saying Christianity and philosophy are the same thing. So this is a model for the history of metaphysics. So he's giving us this his natural history of metaphysics, could it be really spelled out, would I think be on the model of his natural history of religion, where he's not interested in whether Plato or Aristotle got it right or anything like that. But it's a contextualized, historicized account of how philosophical views emerge without prejudice to their truth or falsity. And in that sense, it's a naturalization of metaphysics along the lines of the naturalization of theology. And that would be a very powerful discipline. Because you stand the problem of just boring sociologization of religion, relativization of religion, sociologization of metaphysics. But if you can avoid that path, then I think you've got a very powerful.
Any other questions? I was thinking about asking a question. It's you mentioned that sort of empiricism, rationalism that became sort of the model of understanding, early modern philosophy. It's and anyone, I mean, I agree completely with you. Anyone who's ever read an early modern philosopher is going to have a hard time strictly applying that distinction or dichotomy. But we often need those kinds of sort of organizing concepts when it comes to telling sort of at least a grander narrative of a historical period. So, are there better concepts like that than empiricism, rationalism, or should we avoid those altogether?
I think you can avoid. I think, well, they obviously do contain some bits of truth. There are fundamental divergences that they capture, but then they create other divergences that are quite non-existent, like schools. You know, there's nothing that links Descartes, Spinoza, Leibniz that separates them out from Locke, Berkeley, Hume. You know, there's not, that really doesn't work. I think there are. It kind of depends who these categories are for. That one I think is so misleading that it shouldn't even be an introductory philosophy process. For people who work in early modern philosophy as opposed to just being a period, there are more fine-tuned distinctions. They're not all binary distinctions like that. There are more fine-tuned distinctions that prove useful. But see, in the case of speculative versus, or the case of metaphysical versus anthropological conceptions of human understanding, You'd never get to that if you're working with a rationalism empiricism distinction, because it reduces everything to epistemology. And it's deleterious, not just in the history of philosophy, it's deleterious in the history of science as well, because Quare, who really kind of shapes the history of science in the 20th century, works on an explicitly philosophical model. He takes his model for the history of science from the history of philosophy, and it's like a rationalist empiricist. It's Platonist versus Aristotelian. It's, you know, Galileo, the kind of mathematician, versus all these empirical kind of grubbing about types. And effectively, what he does is he reduces to science to an expression of a successful epistemology. So the history of science becomes the triumph of a successful epistemology, namely mathematical formulation of the world against an empirical one. And that's much more disastrous than anything I know of even in philosophy. Yeah. So it isn't so much that they mischaracterize issues, that certain questions are just completely excluded, like the anthropological thing, and other divisions, and when that distinction is applied in other cases, it leads one to completely misconstrue the nature of modern science, I think.
Well, that was suddenly.
I want to follow up on the answer you gave to the question prior to the last one about the idea of a history of not religion or a history of metaphysics being a kind of depiction or description of human activity that deny truth or falsity, a kind of naturalization. But then you said avoiding the sociologization that would be rather boring, and I take that you mean something like a more or less statistical.
I hope there's no sociologist present.
I think you have something like a statistical kind of what and where kind of, or maybe not, but I wonder if you could tease out the difference there between sociologization and naturalization.
Well, sociologization is a form, could be a form of naturalization. The question is whether it's, I mean, there is no such thing as naturalization to a core. I think one of the things that learned work in the 18th century is that there are competing naturalizing strategies, and they marginalize one another, they dominate. So there's not, you can't just be committed to naturalization. There's particular programs of naturalization that are in competition with one another. Sociologization, I mean in a disparaging sense that sociologists recognize and don't do, which is the kind of fitting, which is a kind of template fitting. So you have this kind of template that that you can apply equally to, I think, to some forms of sociology of science here as well. Some template that you can apply to, you know, ethnomethodology, to telephone conversations, sale of washing powder, the scientific revolution, theories of mind. Anything the kind of template can be put on, it focuses on the daily lives of practitioners and how they make decisions, and it's the same in each case. And this is an extreme case, because what it does is it robs the discourse of any specificity. So it robs science and philosophy of any cognitive content. You can think of them as commercial operations or as other kinds of. So what you want, and here I think Herder is exactly on the right track, if you naturalize language in such a way that you don't take any account of its distinctive cognitive claims or cognitive content, then you just reduced it away, you eliminate it. You haven't explained it, you've just explained it away. And that's not the route you want to go down. So to the extent to which sociologization does that, to the extent to which sociologization fails to capture what's distinctive about metaphysics, what's distinctive about its claims, it wouldn't work. So naturalization is actually really is a delicate fine-tuned thing. We don't tend to think of it in those terms because we just think of reduction to physics, which is just crude and hammer-like. You've got physics, it works, let's just take anything we've got and see if we can do anything competent we've got and reduce it to that. But actually, when you get to the details, it's very, very difficult to retain the kind of content of the disciplines in the right way, retain its composite content, keep its distinctiveness, and account for it in different terms. And I was just using sociology as an example of a discipline that in which it would be very difficult to do that, in which it would be very difficult to mean as an arts.
Thank you. I was curious about how, going back to thoughts about natural history, but how natural history would avoid falling into a form of historicism, so that if I'm doing a natural history of some particular discipline, how do I know that I'm not doing a natural history of some particular discipline at some particular point in time? That's sort of culturally contextual or specific to some particular time. So how do I know that I'm actually, for instance, doing natural history of religion? And I think if I start to answer that question, sort of what's the nature of religion, then I'm turning it into something more metaphysical or speculative. So I'm just sort of curious, how do I actually get some kind of objective knowledge out of natural history?
Right, I think you can't. I think that's a very good point. I think you just got to, there's no pre-given answers here. You can make mistakes on this project, and you can go nowhere. I mean, one case I've looked at recently is the case of religion. I mean, historicization is a form of contextualization, basically. Look at the history of thinking about religion. Prior to the 17th century, Christian theologians think that Judaism, Islam, are forms of heresy. So if you want to understand them, you just try and identify what forms of heresy they are. Then in the 17th century, they realize that actually these can't be forms of heresy because they're just too far away from Christian doctrine. But they nevertheless do have a kind of religious core. So the thought comes into existence that these are different religions, that there is not just one religion that's got orthodox and heretical variants. There are in fact different religions. And there's Christianity, Judaism, Islam, and then some general category of the rest. The 19th century, this is elaborated, and you get, I think, 12 world religions on this. How are these differentiated? They're differentiated on what their core theological beliefs are. Now, if there's one distinctive thing about Christianity, is that it defines itself in terms of its core theological beliefs. None of these other religions do. They do it in terms of, you know, practices, daily practices of kind of cleansing and things like that, meditation, senses of spirituality, return to a homeland. Some of them, like versions of Buddhism, don't even posit a God. Some of them, like Judaism, do, but you don't have to believe in God to be a part of that religion, so-called. So what you've done is, you've taken something that's really distinctive to Christianity, that doesn't bear any relation to how the other things define themselves, and distinguished them on that basis. And it looks like you've done something really interesting and objective and anthropological by marking out these different things in terms of their core beliefs. But if that's not how these things see themselves, it's a completely Christocentric, whatever the word is, Christocentric exercise, and it's a dead end. How can you tell that in advance? You can't. You know, you just have to go down the path and see what happens. And that's true of all these naturalizing projects. You know, one I've been working on, anthropological medicine in the second half of the 18th century, is easily the most ambitious form of naturalization. Replaced metaphysics with medicine, with a particular kind of medicine and sensibility. And it collapsed. It just didn't work. And competing forms of naturalization kind of overtook it. But when it starts off, it really looks like it's promising. It looks really powerful. It looks like it has all the answers. But yeah. So you just can't tell in advance.
Yep.
So I think this is related to that point. I'm wondering if you can tell even after the fact, because when you do when you tell a history, it can always be rewritten, and there's always many ways of looking at something, and there are interpretive elements that go into that, and so there's always going to be the possibility that we will later look back and say that wasn't the way it was. So does that undermine the role that the historical dimension can play?
Not if that's a merely philosophical doubt. Not if that's just merely skeptical. Because then that's like an apartment saying, well, you know, all of science might be completely wrong. You know, it's possible we've got everything wrong, basic physics, basic chemistry. But obviously that's not something we have to take into account in making decisions about things. It's just, it's a purely skeptical possibility. If what you're raising is a purely skeptical or relativist possibility that could hold pretty well about anything, then that doesn't. But if you've got, you know, specific good reasons for thinking that in particular cases, or through experience you realize you should be worried about particular kinds of claims, then yeah, you have to be cautious. But being cautious and realizing what the intellectual risks are of certain kinds of projects, or what the possibilities of a dead end would be, is something you can find out about. I mean, it's not theoretical. You can look at, as I've been recommending, look at the history of these things and see, try and learn from that, from the history of science, how these things have worked. So long as it's not a merely hypothetical doubt, if it's a merely hypothetical doubt, then there's nothing to worry about. If it's not, then if you've got particular reasoned arguments as to why you should be worried in a particular case, then yeah. But that's the same for everything. There's nothing, I don't think there's a special problem here about history. That's just a general problem.
I think time is up. So, thank you very much.